This is the city.
Live.
At Sirius XM Los Angeles Studios.
Los Angeles, California.
Dr. Laura Live.
This
is the Dr. Laura program on Sirius XM Triumph.
Of information. I came up yesterday and I did the radio show from the studios upstairs and I brought my jacket. Nice jacket, huh? I brought the sneaks, very comfortable. I brought the socks. I brought the shirt. And I forgot my pants. So we finished the show yesterday and we all get into the elevator, all the peeps and me. And as we're going down the elevator, I don't know, I just have this terrible feeling. So there I am in the elevator, somebody else is holding the jacket, it has the plastic on it and all of that. And I go looking underneath to see if I put the pants in. It's like, oh my God! So I said, we have an emergency. I don't have any pants. And of course, peeps came up with various solutions like, well, the jacket's pretty long. Maybe this way you can get a date. So I went to two stores and went in and said, what I need, jeans, patch pockets, short enough I don't have to hem them. I don't like, you know, those. And no. And then I went to the second store and the lady said, let me check way in the back. Because this style is not in anymore. The style that's in now is these huge, voluminous legs. And when you're my size, which is 5'2" on a good day, you just look like a little, yeah, you know what I mean. So the lady came out at last. I was practically in tears thinking, what am I going to do? I'm just going to wear sweatpants. And so I found these. So I need a round of applause for my pants. Thank you. Thank you. All right, Lilybug, here or there. Come here, sweetie. This is Lily. Okay. Now, during the program here, she will just come and sit on your laps. I hope you don't mind. You know, that just means you're a very nice person because you know how intuitive dogs are. Okay, show me the nicest person in the audience. Come on. Everybody's sitting there going, ah, shit. All right, let me start. Thank you very much for all your questions, because this is what I like to do. I like to respond to your ideas, your desires, your needs, you know. Hi, Dr. Laura.
Hi.
How did you become interested in sailing and in racing? And do you sail for fun or only do races? Oh, I like that question. This is how I got into it. I had a little itty-bitty powerboat, and I moved to Santa Barbara. And the itty-bitty powerboat was for freshwater, and the engine doesn't work when you go into saltwater. And so I would have had to get another little itty-bitty saltwater boat. Anyway, I thought, you know, I'm just going to take a little lesson in one of those sailboats. It's kind of stupid, though, because in a powerboat, if I want to go from here to there, I steer here to there. You go on a sailboat, and you have to have an angle to the wind, just like the airplane with the flaps and all of that. So you have to do this. That seemed rather dumb to me. But anyway, on a beautiful, sunny afternoon, I went and went on this 24-foot boat, and the teacher, she said to me, okay, sit here, and here's the tiller. Pull this way to make it go that way. Okay. Push it that way, and you'll go that way. That makes just as much sense. And here's the rope you pull and to keep the sail in or out. And it's like, come on, I've never been on one of these things before. It's just too much information. And you watch those two little pieces of cotton or wool, whatever they are, and you try to keep them both going at the same time. So you have to, all right. So I go out there, and of course, it's a little breezy, so we're like this. And she doesn't look panicked, so I tried not to panic. And it was quiet. Birds flew by. Some dolphin flipped around the boat. And that was it. I was sold. So I got myself, she said, walk around the marina and see what boat speaks to you. And I thought, okay, she smokes some good stuff. And so I walked around and a boat spoke to me, which is scary enough since I was totally clean and sober. And so I got a little boat and I had no idea what to do with it. And I thought, you know, you buy a car. What does it have? Tires and a steering wheel, right? You buy a boat, it has nothing. You have to buy the sails. You have to buy everything. I didn't know that. So all that gets put on the boat. And I'm sitting there one day eating a peanut butter and jelly sandwich, not knowing what to do with the boat. And this guy walks by and says, what's your PHRF number? It's your rating when you race. It's a handicap, like when you golf. And I said, I don't know. Aren't you going to race? No, this is just for fun. Okay. So I got somebody to teach me. We went out one day, and there were a group of people doing a race for one of the other clubs. And he said, do you want to race? I said, no. So we went over and started racing. He was a pushy dude. And I was scared to death. And basically he said, you will learn how to sail this boat when you race, because you'll have to think quickly. And in a race, you have to think quickly. For trimming and driving and everything, it has to be fast. So we went out there. And it's a hell of a lot of fun and a challenge. Although when I started racing more seriously, before the start line, my heart would be doing this, and I'd be going, what am I doing to myself? And I wasn't even sure, you know, if the sails are on the right, I have no rights. If the sails on the left, I have rights. They don't. Are they on the left? Are they right? So you have to learn all of this stuff, and it was very challenging. And I love it. I mean, it's not racing or fun. It's fun. It's all fun. You work with a crew of people. It's the first time in my life I had been involved in something that was not just me alone. You play tennis, it's you alone. You're on the radio, it's you alone. Everything I do, it's me alone. I write a book, it's me alone. I had to be part of a team, and it took me a couple of years to really have that sink into my head that if I won or lost, I didn't win or lose. We won, we lost, and if somebody screwed up, we have to back them up. If I screw up, they have to back me up. And for the first 2 years, when I screwed up, which happened quite often, I would be in the back of the boat and cry. Tears were coming down my face. And the guys would turn around and go, oh, shit. Oh, dear. You know, and finally, one of them said, no time for that. Focus. And that was it for crying. So it's all fun. What is the best way to teach your small kids gratitude when others around the world have much less without making them feel guilt or shame? First of all, your little kids don't know there's a world, flat or round. They have no clue about a world. They know their home. They know something that happens at school or somebody else's house. And when you run a house like the following, sweetie, to your kid, can you pass me the, thank you, honey. Honey, can you get the cup for mommy? Thank you, honey. Can you please do this? Thank you, honey. And kids learn immediately, please and thank you, because they see the parents always doing it with each other. Oh, you got me coffee? Thank you, sweetie. That was so nice of you. That's how kids learn gratitude. They see it every minute of every day. And a lot of you figure, I'm sorry, I'm picking on you because you're here. A lot of you figure you only have to say it if you get a present. No, it's every moment of the day, and it becomes quite natural. And then your kids naturally, please, may I, can I? I learned the difference between may I and can I from my dad, who used to get exasperated when they were used interchangeably. Can means are you physically able? May is asking for permission. Okay, don't want to ask for permission. They might say no. So the best way to teach your kids gratitude is to show it all the time in your marriage, in your family, and with your kids. What is a woman like you? No, why is a woman like you not dating anyone? I heard you indicate that on air. I don't know. You have anybody to introduce me to? It's hard pickings at my age. I'm like not your typical 76-year-old. And so, you know, somebody, a guy 50 could probably keep up to me, but I'm not a cougar. Guy 80 It's almost waving goodbye.
You know, it's a good haircut when it goes back into place.
Who do you talk to when you need help with a situation? I've had a tough morning. I have certain dear friends, and I count on them. One of them is sitting right there. That's Patty. Many of you have heard me talk about Patty. When I went through my cancer fun and chuckles, she was there for every moment. And then let me tell you something weird. She was there for every moment, and I was kind of scared and upset and worried and fretting, and they have to go through all the tests because I said, let's get this surgery done quickly. Because I like things, you have to do it, get it done. And at one point, I was getting a test, and I just lost it because it was so painful. And she just lay herself on top of me as I lay there. And then she whispered in my ear, I'm sorry I'm doing this in front of you. No, I'm not. She said, we're going to go home soon. And I got to tell you, I could not have gotten through that as well without her. She then, you know, you can... If you're a good empath, which she is, you can only take a certain amount in and then your head explodes. So she decided to go visit her brother who lives close to me. He wasn't around. So she pulls into a parking lot of a grocery store and just sits there to breathe. And there's a car parked right across from her. It was her brother. Wow. Yeah, it got a whoa. Whoa. That is so weird. It's like something meant to be. And she's very spiritual, so... I think it paid off. Hi, DL. Hi. Of all the locations you have visited around the world, which place would you most excite? Would you be most excited to visit again? Japan. I'm very into Japanese art, Japanese culture, you know all of that. Yeah. I am a recent widow with good days and some difficult days. I know they have good intentions, but my friends always ask me how I'm doing. How can I respond to them when I don't want to feel obligated to come up with an answer? Then just, again, the gratitude thing. Thank you for being concerned about how I am. Some days better than others, but I really appreciate that you cared enough to ask. Isn't that the real answer? Somebody was gracious and gave a damn about you. You know, you're all walking around having your private lives. You don't know anything about the person I can't see because the lights are too bright. You don't know anything about them. You have your world. But when somebody enters your world to see how you are in your world, be very grateful. Say, thank you so much for caring. I feel like shit. No. How can my spouse and I communicate better without turning it into a fight? The reason these conversations generally turn into fights is that each one of you is thinking about yourself. Don't get excited yet. I'm not saying you're totally selfish creep, but it's natural because we are entities that are concerned with our survival. Even in a relationship. So when I would have couples in therapy and one would complain about the other and it would start getting too close to an edge, I'd say, do you really believe he or she really does not have your best interest at heart? Do you really believe they don't care? And all of a sudden the room changes and there's confusion. Well, I'm behaving like I don't think he or she cares. And you're both doing that. So we had an interesting call, several calls. This is very noisy today, this part. I don't weigh that much. I don't know what this is. Where it always starts to end up into a fight. Well, if the moment you see your better half is agitated, why don't, instead of getting defensive, you just say, honey, I can see you're getting very upset. I don't think I really appreciated listening to you enough to understand what was upsetting. So please, tell me again. Fight's over. Why? Because you give a damn about him, her. I'm not doing pronouns. I'm just saying male and female, okay? Trust me, no pronoun shakers here. If you show the other person, if you show your spouse that you care about how they feel more than you care about winning the argument, the marriage is beautiful. It is. So show that you care about what's going on with them. Because if we're talking and suddenly you can see that I'm getting like this, obviously it really isn't about this thing. It's something else. And that's why when people call about these things, I ask for examples. Because even in the wording of the examples and the example, I learn something about, there's a message. It's like I have to do a translation from these words to what's behind them. Like yesterday, this woman was really about her husband, and I said, he's depressed. And he, take me back to when this started, it was 3 years. I mean, these things just sort of fall together. He lost his job. Okay, he no longer feels like a man. So they were arguing about the toilet seat up or down. Well, the symbolism for him is she wasn't respecting the toilet seat up, he's a man. She wants him to put it down. Then he says, well, why don't you put it up when you're finished for me? I'm the man. Listen to what's behind, okay? As opposed to just knowing we're right because we're women. That was sarcasm. I mean, do you hear anything in the show that sounds like I'm anti-male? No. My needy mother always wants attention and gifts, which I'm no longer providing. How can I stop feeling guilty about my choice? You don't feel guilt. This is the singular word in the entire English language which is most overused. Love should be most overused, but it isn't. It's guilt. You don't feel guilty. Half the time you're pissed, angry, sad, upset, or you don't give a damn. But it's uncomfortable. And for some reason, we tend to take that feeling and call it guilt because whenever we think about it, we're uncomfortable, usually somewhere around here. It tightens up. It's not guilt. Guilt means you've done something immoral, illegal, unethical, or you've pissed off Dr. Laura. That's it. Otherwise, no. It's a bunch of other feelings, and if you would only take the time to be truthful about it, you're pissed off that you spent most of your life trying to appease your mother, like appeasing the gods, and trying to make her be nice to you and love you, and it has failed. And you're freaking tired of it. What you are is sad that you don't have that kind of mommy, and you're sad that you never will. And you're sad that you put so much effort into, I don't know, a black hole. It's not guilt. How do I handle coworkers who don't seem interested in helping me as a new hire? It's been 3 weeks, their attitude has not changed. Well, unfortunately, I don't know more about this. New people coming in sort of upsets the order of things and makes people actually nervous about their position. Will it change? Will the people they're close to now change and be close to that? There's all kinds of stuff that goes down. Will they be elevated? Gee, they're younger. They don't know anything. Are they going to respect me? So the best way to handle this is to, if there's something in particular you know you need to learn, check it out. See who seems to know how to do it. And go up to them and say, you know, I'm having a hell of a time with this, and I notice that you're really good at it. Yes, I am. And I would really appreciate if you could help me out. Of course. That's how you play the game, okay? How do you keep balance with all the negativity in the world? Because I'm a big purveyor of positivity. And we can only, we each have a sphere that we live in. My sphere is bigger because I have a radio signal, but we each have a sphere and we do as much as we can within that sphere. And just think about it. If everybody in the universe did the same thing, everything would be better. It never happened. The history of the world has always sucked. Let's be honest. But in our sphere, there's something we can do to make it positive. And that's what you have to focus in on. Lily, do you want to show off a little bit? Come here, girl. I want everybody to see how cute you are. Come here. Okay, up. Walk. Good girl. Okay, now she's a poodle and a female poodle, and sometimes they go, make me. Down. Okay, roll over. Noah. See what I said? Down. Lily, roll over. Over. Okay, let's try it again. Lily, over. Yes. Okay, sit. Leave it. Leave it. Leave it. Lily, here. Okay, go get it. Anything else you want to see? Okay, Lily, circle. Good. Lily, circle. Okay, heel. Good. Anyway, she's cute as a button. Now, she's a service dog. And for anxiety. Ready? Lily? Lily, hug. So if you wonder how I stay centered, she's trained. And she's, besides that, she's just loving. Okay, go hassle somebody in the audience. It's okay, you can go now. It's okay, you can go now. Yeah, good. Okay, Lily, come here. Climb, climb. Good girl. Good girl. Okay, let's get back to you folks. Yeah, you're looking at these little pieces. You may get them later. Forget about it now. Okay, how do you keep balance? Yeah, I answered that. And her. Not a question, but bless you for guiding me through the unexpected passing, of my 35-year-old son. You helped me choose joy between now and dead. Hugs, whoever you are. Hugs. How do I live my life to the fullest and not always think about my age and ruin it? Put this much makeup on. You won't worry about how old you are. You don't think I looked this good yesterday. Okay. How do I live my life to the fullest and not always think about my age and ruminate on how many years I have left on this earth? It terrifies me to think at 60, I may have only 20 years left in this life. Only 20 years? You're lucky if you get to 20 years, woman. Okay, I'm 76. I went on the net for those sites that tell you how long you're going to live and you put all the information about you. It was very fun. One said I was going to live to 100. The other said I was going to live to 101. I didn't know which one I was happier about because I sure will look like a Sharpay by then. And I started to fret about it a bit, the age thing, because, you know, you do downward facing dog in yoga in shorts. Don't do it in shorts. And you open your eyes and you see above your knees, wrinkle, 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 wrinkle. I was upside down going, what the hell happened to my, they're not there now. The answer, don't go upside down and look. But I look at it this way because, you know, we all don't want to think that we're not going to be here someday. My thought is, however long it is, I want to go out like that. No pain, no fear. That's my plan. Can't always plan that, but that is my plan. Second thing is, between now and dead, I'm going to squeeze every frickin' moment out of it. Instead of worrying about how many moments I have to squeeze, I'm just squeezing, babies. Just keep squeezing every day. Think of something wacky to do. Buy yourself new jeans. I got to tell you, I was kissing these. I almost slept hugging them. I was so happy. I just try to take every day. How many days do I have? As long as I fill them well. If I am not able to fill them well, then I'm done. How did you become such a mama jamma? Mama jamma. What is a mama jamma? A badass? It's just natural. How did you become so successful while being an at-home mom? Any advice to those looking to do the same? It really is easy. You just decide your priorities. And my priority was, I'm a mother and a wife. I got a family. That's it. So, for example, when I was writing my books, I got up at 5 in the morning. I was younger. I could do that. I get up 5 in the morning now, and it's like, oh, God, help me. So 5 in the morning, and I would write for a couple of hours. Everybody doesn't have to get up till about 7 to get ready to go to school and work. That's it. And then my son didn't even know I was working because I'd take him to school. I'd do the radio show at noon. I'd come home, pick him up. That's it. Be up late. You squeeze what it is you want to do around what's most valuable. And that's a choice I made, and it's tough, but it's doable. But I have an interesting brain. I would be in the middle of a sentence while writing the book, and then I'd go, I gotta go, and go to the radio station. And then I'd come home, didn't have to pick him up yet, I'd come home and finish the sentence. I have no idea how I was able to do that. People have always asked me, and I don't know, it works. So the being successful, some good fortune, and not quitting. You are so physically active, how can you just sit there and crochet? Isn't that boring? When I was first or second year in graduate school, I frankly hated it. And so for the summers, I worked at Abilities, which was a school for disabled children and a place where they rehabbed people who were adults, became handicapped. And so I got assigned 1 week to this gentleman who had been almost a pro basketball player. And he was in a car crash. So now he's paralyzed from the waist down. He's in a wheelchair. And I come in and they assign me to him for the 5 days. And he's bending resistor wires. I don't think most of you know what those are, because I don't think there are resistor wires. Everything is technology is way past that. And so I'm sitting there with him for a day and a half and hearing his story. It was very fascinating, you know. And stupid face over here, she's pointing at herself. Stupid face over here went, damn, this is boring. And the minute it came out of my mouth, I went, oh, strike me dead. Just strike me dead. And he turned to me, and he could have really let loose, and he probably should have, but he was such a decent person. He looked at me and he said, well, it is, except in the front, the guys in the suits think you can only do a certain number of these in a certain way in a certain amount of time. And I find ways to show them they're underestimating me. That was one of the most important moments of my life. He could have gotten mad, just called me a bitch and thrown me out. Could have said, aren't you a rude, obnoxious little thing? And I would have said, yeah, I think so. I mean, how else could I have said that? I feel so bad. It's one of those things you're thinking, but you didn't say. But that was such an important lesson. So I look at all things, frankly, as kind of a challenge. It's probably one of the reasons I'm successful at most things that I do. The routine of doing anything can be boring. People have been burnt out doing radio shows. I find every day an amazing, exciting challenge. When I learned to crochet, the knitting with two, I didn't like that. But the crochet, man, that was fascinating. And the patterns were so difficult. And just learning basic things. You have to do two extra chains at the end. What is that? Turning? I could not figure out half the stuff. And now I can read one of those charts that just has dots and dashes. I can do that now. It's a challenge. So that part of it is important for me. The other part that's important for me is that it's meditative. I'm working on something right now that's a purse all in one piece, which means you have to do all of these parts so they fold and you close all the edges. And it's each time I go across, it's 60 complicated stitches that requires 2 stitches and a lot of wrapping. So it takes a lot to get across. And to do that, you're sort of in a, and it's really very relaxing. So I find it very relaxing, unless I realize I screwed up two rows earlier and I have to rip it out. Okay, how do I get...
Excuse me.
Patty.
A little surprise.
This is my show, Patty.
Okay. Mm-hmm. She doesn't realize that I didn't just... I got here and then... Someone said, you know, we have a surprise for her. Would you present it to her? And I said, yes, I will. So this Dr. Laura, dear friend of mine, I call her Laura when I'm around her, has been doing an amazing thing for Children of Fallen Patriots for more than 5 years. So when she's talking about her crocheting and she's talking about all this, you, when you're doing all of that, you've then put it on her design, Dr. Laura design, and raised a lot of money for Children of Fallen Patriots. The Gold Star family, they've lost their dad or their mommy, and they get college funds. And put together what you've done and what your audience has done, it's close to $2 million that you, yay, have helped raise for them to send 200 students approximately to a four-year college with no debt at the end, and it's for Children of Fallen Patriots. And you are amazing. And I adore you, so thank you for letting me present it, because you've done good work. She is really amazing, isn't she?
How do I get... okay, choke me up. Not nice. Thank you. How do I get the self-critical bug out of my ear when I've accomplished personal goals like running a marathon, hiking the Grand Canyon? I'm a smart girl, so this ongoing battle is ridiculous. I think when I was growing up, I thought my middle name was stupid. Because that's what my dad called me all the time. God knows why. Anyway, I found out I wasn't stupid all the way. College, graduate school. I was started teaching at a four-year girls' college in New York. And they assigned me to teach a course of a subject I had never studied, which I thought was brilliant. And I said, I haven't studied this. And they go, we trust you'll handle it. So I would go home with two or three textbooks, read my brains out, and then go in and give a lecture on the subject. I mean, I had a huge background in biology and physiology, but this was something in particular I hadn't studied. And then I went home one day and I went, God, I can absorb this and synthesize it in a way that other people can learn. I must not be... That's it. If you can do these things... then whatever you were told is not true. And that's what you have to tell yourself. Yes, I was told I'm not good enough. This isn't good enough. I'm not wonderful enough. And it's not true. It was a lie. Hope you heard me, whoever wrote this. How can I mend my relationship with my new daughter-in-law and seek her forgiveness of my disapproval of her wanting a prenup? Wait, there's more on the back. I talked to her and asked her what I can do. She said, nothing. It will just take time. Yeah, just let it go. And don't try to kiss her ass forever, okay? Because that won't make a normal relationship. Just let that go. And don't assume she's thinking about it all the time either. The less it's ever brought up and the less guilty and begging you look like trying to have a good relationship, the worse it gets. So just try to normalize situation. What question have you never been asked that you should have been asked? Anybody help me here? I have no idea how to answer that question. Because, I mean, you ask some of them that I'm never, usually never asked, like, how did you do what you do? Instead of saying things can't be done, since I have done them, then how do you do them? As opposed to attacking me on they can't be done and I'm full of nonsense. So that was the sort of thing that I used to get frazzled at. But I can't think of anything. And also, I'm quite open, as you hear on the air. I mean, it took me many, 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 many years to be willing to talk about panic attack syndrome that I dealt with. Looking back, I don't know why. I think I needed to imagine that you needed to see me as, you know, some kind of everything is perfect and everything is in order. No, I'm a person who struggles with my own stuff, as each person in here struggles with their stuff. And as I've gotten older, that's the key. As I've gotten older, I have the confidence that's built. So quite frankly, I no longer care. You want to think poorly of me? Go ahead. I respect me. I work hard. I'm sincere in what I do. And I accomplish a lot. I'm loving to my friends. To my enemies, I ignore. I ignore enemies. I don't let myself get worked up with negativity in that regard. I used to when I was younger. But nothing has ever won that way. So after 76 years and about 50 years on the radio, I have evolved to the point that I am confident. And at some point, you have to say to yourself, self, God, look at what you've accomplished and look at what you've survived. Come on. If at this point you don't approve of you, you must have disdain for everybody. How can you not have disdain for everybody if the amount that you have been and done is not enough for you? And it's amazing how you become more compassionate for the struggles of others when you've been through yours and admire your effort. It's not the accomplishment. Somebody asked me, so what happens when you don't win a race? I still have wine and chips. They have beer and chips and cookies. So as we're bringing the boat back in, whether we win or lose, I have wine and chips. And what I've said is, I have won important races and hated every freaking moment of it. Because I was in a small boat with this guy who was just a tyrant. And he was yelling and screaming at me, and it's 2:00 in the morning. There are no moon, no stars. Jibe. I don't even know what direction I'm going in now. I couldn't figure it out. I was beside myself. It was like 13 hours. I got off the boat, got in a car, and went home. Never got the trophy, never got the bragging right, just went home. The winning isn't everything. The accomplishment isn't everything. It's the texture and the depth. So I have had races where we worked our asses off, laughed our brains out, and lost. And I don't remember if we came in second or third, it doesn't matter to me. We had a damn good time. So, your kids, stop praising their accomplishments. Start praising the effort. Oh my gosh, you spent all those hours studying. I'm so proud of you that you persevered in spite of the fact you were tired, you were hungry, you were annoyed. That's really amazing of you. That's how you raise your kids. That's how you support your spouse. That's how you support your friends. And that is how you talk to yourself. Yeah. Thank you. Where is your favorite place to eat in Santa Barbara? Lucky's for lunch. Why, somebody's there? Lucky's for lunch, sitting outside. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, it's just pleasant. The food's good, but it's just such a pleasant feel. You know, really nice. I think that's my favorite place. My second favorite place would be Stella Mare, around the bird preserve. The building is several hundred years old. The left part, the new, right part's new. It's all la-di-da cuisine. You have to dress up when you go there. Definitely underarm deodorant. How would you like to describe your future in 5 words or less? What the hell? That's an interesting question. How would you like to describe your future in 5 words or less? If I say still alive, I'll just alive. Or else there's no future. Healthy. Still friend? Friend?
Easy.
Friend? Yeah, that's easy one. Thank you. Challenge? Can't do without a challenge. And good food. I may not look like it, but I like to eat. I am 59, have a hard time fearing my mortality. How do I ignore my fears? I especially fear cancer. I've been there, done that. You know, yeah. As I've lost so many family members to it. Well, if you've lost a lot of family members to it, you might have some genetics involved. Mine jumped a generation from my grandmother, but I got breast cancer on one side. But when it was diagnosed, the doctor said, no, calm down a little bit. It's a bad thing to have cancer, but you have one of the best. And I'm laying there thinking, I don't know what that means. So I got a little lucky, got it early. It was a mean cancer, but it wasn't in lymph nodes. So I got lucky. This fear of mortality means you're not living today. I mean, I am not sitting here by myself considering the fact that I only have 30 more years. But if I were not here talking to you, I have a better chance, if I'm not doing anything of any meaning to me, that I'm sitting there thinking about a vast nothing. Because when you're fearing your mortality, you're thinking of a vast nothing, which is why I think it's interesting that that question, what do I see in my future, five words. I mean, that was a tough one. But I have no idea. I'm going to be hit with other challenges, disappointments, successes, frustrations. I mean, I just got this. This is very nice. I appreciate it. You bring beauty into the world. You call a friend and say, let's go do something. If you fill your days, you're not thinking of when you're not going to have any days. So fill your days. Mean something to somebody else. The thing that keeps me going in life is that I mean something to some other people. That is the ultimate purpose in life. If your life, if the fact that you're alive helps somebody else's life, how can you do better than that? What, an Academy Award? I've got awards. I've got a chest full of stuff. I don't even know what most of it is. And I threw a lot of it away because I didn't care. It's not what makes you stop yourself when you're getting negative. That's not what stops yourself when you're thinking of things like mortality. And I think in general, people worry about mortality when they're not today having purpose. So despair is a lack of purpose. I'm recently widowed, 20 months. I have a hobby and enjoy podcasts, and I have great friends. What should I do to be thinking about moving forward? Nothing. You got hobbies, you have friends. You're good. Stop nagging. Jesus, you people nag yourselves. Come on. Oh, I think that's the same thing. How can my husband and I keep the romance alive while raising our daughter, both working from home and then caring for my elderly parents? We always seem to be too tired and busy to take time for just ourselves, and it feels more like we are just roommates instead of a loving couple. The answer is, you can't do all those things. You're going to have to pick and choose and move some aside. Oh my God, I can't do that. You already have. You put your marriage aside. So you're capable of putting something aside. So maybe we should find another way to take care of parents. Maybe we should not have two people working at the same time. Maybe we should sit down and say, what is really the most valuable thing that we have? Our daughter. what is the most valuable thing we have? Each other. So ultimate, and you. You're too cute. You got me trained. Here you go. Well, I don't know where it went. That's okay. She'll find it. Here you go. You can't do all those things and do them well. And what usually suffers is the marriage and the kids. Because when you say you're taking care of your kids, you're driving them to events. It's not the same thing as being with your kids. It's not the same thing as cooking with them, playing with them, reading with them, doing stupid stuff with them, making Jell-O. Both of you stick your hands in the Jell-O before it's ready. I mean, there are fun things. I've had people do things like that as a way of reconnecting with their kids. Go to Denny's, order Jell-O, sit there, and squeeze it together. You cannot do that and be depressed or angry. You should try it. These are simple things in life. You don't have to pay $5,000 an hour to some shrink. Just buy Jell-O. I have a big problem with following through. Yeah, I don't feel like getting to the end of this. I have a big problem following through. I usually will start something and hardly make it to the finish line. Please help. Discipline. When I need to do something, I go, all right, I have to do this, and I have this much time I have to do it in, and then my reward is. That's how I got myself through college and graduate school. I'm going to take this exam. I can't think about the exam. After the exam's over, I'm going to have a pizza. After this exam's over, I'm going to watch a movie. After this exam over, I'm going to sit in a bathtub for 2 days. After this, and so I would leapfrog over the stressful thing and do it. As far as finishing something to its completion, that's discipline. And it's showing respect for your own time. If you spend time starting something and then you stopped it, you just disrespected yourself because this was a task you wanted to fulfill. Do not disrespect yourself. Finish it. Then you will respect yourself. And I don't want you to lose self-respect. What is your secret to staying fit and healthy? I'm very active, and I'm disciplined with it. We take very long walks together, Lily and I, and or friends and Lily and I, or friends without Lily. I play ball. I have stairs. I'm up and down with them all the time. I work out with a trainer. Hardcore. I'm not going to take my jacket off, but you should see the guns. I make it a priority because if I'm not fit and healthy, my life will be shorter and I won't be able to have fun in the time that I do have. And I want to get the most out of the time I have. So do you think I wake up in the morning and go, oh, goody, I'm going to deadlift today? No. I get up in the morning and I go, at 9 o'clock, I'm really going to be happy with myself. As Dorothy Parker, a writer, in the 1900s, my God, that sounds like I'm talking about the 1700s, she said, the joy in writing is having writ. I thought that was always interesting, although I enjoy the process of writing. But the joy of working out hard is sweating afterwards. My husband's family is constantly in our marriage, but he needs to keep fairly good relations with them for future rewards and retirement monies due to law. I don't have to answer that. You already know it. You got your values in the wrong place, or he does. What expectations should a 23-year-old girl have in dating? Most everybody you're going to date is a jerk who wants to get in your pants. Anybody want to disagree with that? How can my husband and I both put our past bad childhoods behind us so they don't continue to impact our marriage? My bad childhood is with me all the time. And when you interact with me, be careful, be gentle, and be very respectful that this is here. Nonsense. I don't care how bad your childhood was. We all have crappy aspects. I thought I was stupid, okay? So we all have that in our childhood. That's not what you bring to a marriage. And if you have that attitude that you have baggage, don't get married until you get rid of the baggage. You have to be willing to get rid of your own baggage. That's your responsibility before you get into a marriage. And then when you're in a situation with your spouse dealing with something, immediately you go into, what's in the best interest of my marriage? What is it I can do to show him I love him? Get up first thing in the morning and think, before you pee and brush your teeth, turn and say to yourself, what can I do to make him, her, happy that they're married to me? Not my baggage, not my childhood. What can I do today? Today, I know the childhood impacts you, but today, as you stand right here, what can you do to make that person happy they married you? That's your responsibility. Not all this psychobabble of, I got triggered. Because if you got triggered, walk out of the room, take a breath, and come back in and care about them. Because if you care about them, you're going to feel so much better. You know how good you feel when you already feel like crap, but somebody walks in the room and you say something nice to them? Do you feel as crappy?
No. No.
God, you people make me work. What should I do when my husband shuts down and doesn't want to talk about a problem we're having? It's awful when he won't talk to me. Are you here with your wife?
Me?
Yeah. Do you mind if I use him as my spouse?
Oh, please.
Okay. She said please. Okay. I'll use you as his spouse because you already are. Okay, get up. Okay, put your hands out. Okay, put your arm around his neck and sit on his lap. Now, turn to him. Sit on his lap. Put your nose and your ear. Wait, come on. Put your near his ear. Yeah. Okay. You're communicating.
Yeah, we do all the time.
Don't mess my hair.
44 years married.
Oh, and I'm not. You're my target here.
Oh, okay.
You're not the wonderful person you are.
Okay.
So what I want you to do is lean into him and say, sweetie.
Sweetie.
Oh, God.
I'm so sorry you were upset. That's it. Okay, stop necking. The show's going to be rated X. Truth be told, and every man will tell you, they're easy to flip. They're in a bad mood. They're irritated with you, they're anything. You sit in their lap, blow in their ear, you can, other stuff that I wasn't going to have you do in front of everybody. And really, that's it. You just get back into being sweet. When you were dating, that's how you behaved all the time. Why do you think you wanted to marry each other? You didn't think intelligently about long-term, about finances and in-laws and religion and kids. You mostly thought, this is so, I feel so good. You know? Go back to that, because when people tap into that well of feeling good, it changes everything. Arguments seem to go away. Really, honey, I wanted, like the lady called, the guy wanted to build a fence next to the house, and then we had a fight about how close it would be to the house. And I said, so you go up to him and say, sweetie pie, honey bunch, stud muffin of mine, would you mind if we put it about another 2 feet so I could plant some flowers? Can I please, sweetie? He'll put it next door if he gets that from his woman. Men are born of a woman. They want to please a woman. You look pleased and happy. They want to please you. Use that. It's natural biopsychology. It's not a thing that happens from era to era. It's built in. It's built in. Be sweet. We have so much power. Sometimes I wish this was a room only of women so I could. We have all the power. He's not going to shut down if you're on his lap and you're going, I really wish, I know you can't stand my mother, but could we just do it this one time? Of course, honey. And this is, just a second, I don't see a clock, so. Oh, I'm good, but come up here. Come up here. This is what I have left, so I need a lot. Okay, somebody in the front row, tell me when I have 1 minute left, okay? I did this again. I pointed with the microphone. Were you ever scared out on the water sailing? Yes. When I raced to Hawaii, we were on shifts. And in the morning, I woke up, and none of the guys are sleeping in the berths. I look around. There's nobody there. So I come, go up the stairs, pick my head out. They're all dressed in high wind gear. I mean, they're all geared up. And nobody is smiling. Nobody says good morning. And I look around. And when you're in the middle of the Pacific Ocean, you are the farthest from any point of land that you are anywhere in the world. So you can see that the Earth is round. It's very clear because you feel like a guppy in a fishbowl. You can see the roundness. And all 360 degrees, squalls. Those are nasty rains with big winds. And we were sort of in the eye of a whole bunch of them. And I just looked around and thought, okay, the guys don't look happy. And so I went down fully geared, took, you know, the metal latches, and I came up, latched myself in, and I was terrified. Fortunately, it was raining so much in my face that they couldn't tell I was crying because they don't like when I cry. And so I didn't go, I was just crying. And the one professional I had on the board was at the helm. So I was secure that we had the best chance of surviving it. Yeah, I was scared. Did I get seasick? No, I was too scared. Too scared to throw up. Why do you think that so many of your calls have to do with adult children and either difficulties in relationships with them or their failure to thrive on their own? When I started out the first 15, 20 years I was on air, I don't think I got one call like that. People got to 18 and went, I'm out of here. I'm going to have a life. I think parenting has changed because I talk to parents who sound so wussy. I can't believe that. They have no sense of how you discipline or how you have a household with a focus on morals, values, principles, and ethics. Religion is down. People participating in religion is down. Marriages, I never knew growing up anybody who got divorced. Never in my 18 years. No parents were divorced. There was not divorce, remarried, visiting things. The drug culture started in the 60s, but that doesn't explain much. The internet, the disconnect in a nuclear family is what's caused the problem. And feminism has had a lot to do with that because it disrespected the nuclear family and the supreme importance of a mother. I cannot believe that women are really willing to believe that they can be replaced by hired help. I mean, they're born in your womb, they suckle at your breast, and you think hired help, when their brains are still forming, replaces you? All of this chaos, and men are the evil empire, there are just so many things that funnel into this. But I think one of the problems is that the lack of cohesion in families and the marriages that aren't really good marriages anymore is that the kids get used as glue for the marriage. Because I've seen many circumstances where the kids kept failing coming home, and that's when the parents stopped fighting and had something finally in common. So there are a lot of things that go into this, but it is very sad. Let's see if I can get a funny one in before the end. How can I be a badass like you when I'm your age? Get tattoos, get a motorcycle. Okay. Can I get your upper body workout? We have workout Wednesdays on my Facebook and Instagram. Just look there. All my exercises are there. Who has taught you the most about life and living it well? Oh, that's a pretty good one that we probably have to end on. Let me think about that. There is no one person because there are many lessons I had to learn. And I'm sorry, I'm going to do this again. One I learned from that woman, Patty. She taught me a big lesson. I had a raging fight on the phone with her. She was not fighting. I was screaming. I'm going to do this. She used to tell me she loves me. And every time she said that, I just got pissed off. Don't say that. And then she used to say, God loves me. I get more pissed off. Don't say that. Because I was not brought up in a loving home. So I didn't understand what she was talking about. And we didn't talk to each other, what, almost a year? For almost a year, yes. We didn't talk to each other. And then she had somebody send me some herbs. And I said, who sent these? And lady said, your friend Patty. It's like, shit. Shit. So she was the person who taught me I could accept love.
I'm so happy because you are very lovable.
I've never said that in person because I've never talked much about my childhood because I don't wear it on my shoulder. But without you, I wouldn't be as happy as I am because you taught me to accept being loved. Oh, and thank you.
You're easy to love, and you are very lovable.
And I hate you because you're so gorgeous. Oh. Okay. Any last things you want to say or no? Oh, I love you guys. I really do. I really do. I get on the air every day, and when I can have a really good interaction with somebody at the end who says, oh, my God, this changed my life, I'm on a cloud. And this is what I've committed my life to. And I'm glad you are receiving it in such a positive way, and I appreciate it very much. So now go do...